LSU score.
What do you do every time LSU loses with that poor tiger in the garage?
He gets covered up.
And if he loses with the next, if he loses 8 out of 11, 7 out of 11.
He stays just covered for the whole year.
That's all. Case rest. Case rest.
Get him some, get him well. Let the Tigers give him hell. Hey!
But the LSU, LSU got beat, he cried.
And you got more sense than him.
LSU, LSU.
You can't even spell LSU.
It is untrue that in Louisiana, the only thing people talk about between August and December is LSU football. They also discuss Tulane, Grambling, Southern, McNeese, and New Orleans Saints football. Fans may express it differently, but xenophobia in football are as American as, well, baseball and apple pie. For instance, a man, after watching his team fumble 7 times in one game, shot himself in the head. Another, on the way to a game, accidentally drove into 12 feet of water, crawled out, and flagged a ride to the stadium, leaving his car underwater. Still another has trimmed his house in his favorite team's colors. Then there is the man who wears the same colored socks every day. Or how about the guy who suffered a heart attack on a Saturday morning and went to a football game on the same afternoon? Incidentally, with the exception of the attempted suicide, all these people are men of LSU.
Bob, how about you letting the people hear what you drive the stands crazy with every now and then when you go into either Tiger Stadium or on the road? How do you do the go Tiger? Do that for us. Watch them.
Go Tigers!
If you should say Chinese bandit with slanty eye, we'll stop a touchdown eating Cajun jambalaya. Remember.
The Chinese bandit is Armin Steger, who went to Tiger Stadium a few hours after his heart attack. His doctor was neither sadistic nor negligent. Since Armin had firmly announced he would listen to the game, the doctor agreed that he might as well die in the stadium as next to a transistor radio.
Wet from head to toe. I mean, they were wringing wet.
I think full of mud.
Full of mud. And we asked them what happened, and believe it or not, they went into that deep canal with their automobile, swam out of the car, stood up on the highway, and to go to a football game. Now, where in the world are you going to get beach beer? Jerry Hines. I don't know what the other man's name is.
Jerry Hines, the owner of Homedale Inn.
We had an andouille oyster and chicken gumbo. Oh, delicious it was.
Jeremiah Hines is a legend out of the bayou, literally. Fellow Tiger fans have suitably nicknamed him Captain Nemo.
Now, what happened was this. I was trying to change the radio, and what happened was the tires went off. Chuck yelled, "You're off the road." I swung it back, and before we knew it, we were in the middle of the bayou.
We didn't feel any hurts until, I guess, about the fourth quarter. Things started hurting a little. And all the way back on our ride, you know, it was hurting, got a little worse.
Now, the thing that really hit us was when I went to get out of the car at my house, I couldn't straighten up because all my ribs and everything was hurting. But I'll tell you this, it's a good thing to have your tickets in your pocket. It's a good thing not to have windows that are electric.
You know, you got fanatics all over the country, and I guess here, you know, you have your share. Lots of LSU fans, not lots, but a lot of real fanatical fans really did not attend LSU. They kind of adopt LSU. I guess that might be like Notre Dame, and in some cases. But you have there's a group in New Orleans called the Year Round Tiger Boosters, which has I think more than 1,000 members, and lots of these people have no connection with LSU other than the fact that they just love LSU football.
At LSU, football is, as they say, a tradition. This means they have won more games than they have lost. Maintaining this happy proportion is, among other things, expensive. Hence, booster clubs have become more than simply a socially acceptable outlet for passion. Less than 10% of the country's college athletic departments finish a year in the black, and booster clubs and foundations often make up the difference. Naturally, Notre Dame leads all leagues. Its foundation raised over $100 million last year. LSU's varsity club represents a more typical example. Of the 21 sports offered, only football and basketball make money, but what they earn will not support the other sports. Indirectly, then, the $1 million donated by the LSU Varsity Club is significant. It is not used in the general operating fund, but all goes directly into scholarships.
All proceeds collected will go to a special scholarship fund designed to provide financial assistance to the Tangipahoa Parish area and residents wishing to attend LSU State University.
At first glance, these preseason socials differ little from any leisure class outing, except, of course, for the preponderance of the color purple and the number of young men who are built like tanks. It is not surprising that the players take time out for this. To put it bluntly, many of the fans paid for them. They might as well look at them.
What do you want it at?
My arm.
Your arm?
No, 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 I want a piece of paper.
Got a little Tiger fan here. Might have to go up in size.
Let's see if this is going to fit.
Get over his head. Oh, yeah.
I'll tell you what. It's part of the room.
Mommy.
Let's see. Yep.
Think that does all right?
Yeah, that does all right. Mike,
my tiger, stood up in the water. If it holds your money, you fight tonight. Keep going, you pick the rain for LSU.
Yes, hey, look me over. Land me in here. Fresh out of clover, mortgage up to here. Don't pass the plate, folks. Don't pass the cup. I figure whenever you're down and out, the only way is up. And I'll be up like a rosebud, high on the vine. Don't thumb your nose, but take a tip of mine. I'm a little bit short of the elbow room, but let me get me some. And look out, well, yeah, I got.
When it sinks into me that we lost, I go into deep depression for about a week. At least a week, okay? And usually it takes about a week for me for it to sink in. And,
Fanaticism has been defined as redoubling your effort when you have forgotten your aim. It does not describe an LSU fan. He does not bark like they do in Georgia or call pigs as in Arkansas. His support is resolute, not to be confused with the exuberance of a college student who is blowing off steam. That you outgrow. The fans we are surveying have grown into something. Psychologists explain it as extended childhood, tribal instinct, territorial imperative, and other nonsense. One expert has even measured stress during a game, and not surprisingly, discovered that a real fan often goes through the same emotional hell as a player. That certainly applies to Augie Cross, president of the year-round Tiger Booster Club. Once, a friend suggested that Tulane had a decent football team. Augie didn't speak to him for 3 weeks.
When they lose, we bleed, we cry. It's the same like one time we lost in Florida, and I didn't want to come back. I just, you feel like dying, honestly.
It actually reaches somewhat beyond the grave. At least with a Baton Rouge woman who recently willed that her ashes be sprinkled over Tiger Stadium during an Ole Miss game. Compared to that, the method Jim LeBlanc's family has chosen for support is positively introverted. Mrs. LeBlanc designed these outfits and got the idea for the Tiger fur from watching Doc Severinsen on TV. On the whole, the LeBlancs are well received at LSU's sporting events, but report that in Tennessee, some jerks did throw soft drinks all over them. Maybe the answer is to choose something less obvious, like socks.
The unusual thing, if I have to go to the doctor's office, the dentist, and I walk in the office and I sit down and I pick up a magazine to read and cross my legs, I feel very self-conscious because everybody in the waiting room seems to be staring at my socks with blue suit or brown.
This is Harold Pelias, another dyed-in-the-wool LSU fan. To be precise, writ number 18 dyed in the wool. That is the color purple.
I built a little, reserve, not too much, but you'll notice it'll be different colors.
I don't wear anything whether I'm working, going to funerals, wakes, weddings.
And
this degree of enthusiasm obviously has to spill out of the sock drawer and onto the walls and doors.
I don't believe I did. I think my son did it. This was, I think, a combination of loss to Tulane or a tie with Rice. One of the LSU basketball games. The radio was damaged to where he had to buy himself another transistor radio to listen to the
graphic support is not limited to interior design, or in this case, redesign. For example, Curly Brissett in New Orleans East is well known because of the outside of his house. As is often true with the more demonstrative fans, individual expression of support is not as much a measure of love for LSU as it is the parameters of a wife's patience.
We started moving a little slowly. We just came in with the drapes in the house, and we had the purple, the gold sofa and the carpet and a few pictures. The ambition, what I'd like to, I don't know if I should say this on camera, but what I'd really like to do is have something on the roof as a tiger stepping out of the stadium and under that Death Valley. That's my last ambition.
This proclivity to Lebensraum has forced some wives, do we dare call them tigerettes, to limit the fan to one room, combined with a vigorous program of containment. Jack Andoni, a New Orleans physician, is an example. Here is an instance where a broken washing machine spawned a museum.
We had a garage in our previous house, and a hose on a washing machine burst. It flooded three rooms of carpet, so we had to throw the carpet out in the garage. And I just asked my wife one day, why don't we get a purple rug or a gold rug and make a purple and gold room out of it? And she thought I was crazy. My involvement is also good therapy for me. I don't have any hobbies. I don't golf or fish or do a lot of things. My hobby happens to be LSU. So in a way, I guess it's therapy for me too.
These vans, sort of rolling LSU triptychs, are becoming increasingly prevalent. One of the first fans to have one was Gene Ogeron from Harvey. Swabbed in 25 coats of lacquer, it is a dazzling $30,000 example of the high cost of cheering.
One of our famous ball players from the past, Billy Cannon, All-American Heisman Trophy winner. YHL before his time. You can tell by the difference of the helmet. It's a little older. And this is Ronnie Estee, plays for LSU, local bar from Bayou Lafourche down there. And Fred Miller. And this is Tommy Casanova. This is
Many LSUers have almost encyclopedic recall of former Tiger players. It is a legitimate interest. LSU football goes way back. What they played was almost another game. Turn-of-the-century football was called a train wreck. One play could last 5 minutes. It was not considered over until the referee said so. A player left the game only when an injury prevented him from continuing. It wasn't a game for sissies. In fact, by 1905, the game had reached an apotheosis of violence. 150 people were badly injured, and 18 died. Teddy Roosevelt threatened to ban the game. LSU's seasons were better than average for the first 25 years. In 1909, they were undefeated with a team largely composed of imported ringers, a practice employed by a number of southern schools. That year, during the Auburn game, a player named Cap Gandy, perhaps setting the style for unborn Tiger fans, threw an opposing player into the eight-piece band that performed along the sidelines. It may be the last recorded instance where an LSU player was more rambunctious than the fans watching him. That would all change soon enough. Huey Long was coming their way.
Our slumber, America.
Huey had a healthy interest in LSU football. He composed a fight song, hired and fired coaches and band directors. Some say his interest in the band surpassed that of the team. He actively recruited players and supervised their training table by forcing some to drink sour milk, his personal prescription for health. On at least one occasion, he roamed the sidelines and called plays. And following an especially thrilling win, he summarily appointed an LSU quarterback to the legislature, rather excessive, even in Louisiana. When the Barnum and Bailey Circus was going to open on a Saturday night, the Kingfish effectively canceled the performance by threatening the owners with the prospects of dipping all their animals at the state line. When he felt that LSU fans should travel to games at reduced rates, he blackjacked the railroads with the threat of a $4 million bridge assessment. The owners became LSU fans overnight. Despite the governor's histrionics, LSU did not play a perfect season until the year that has become sort of a date reckoner in Louisiana, 1958. That was also the year that the Tigers won the national championship under a young head coach named Paul Dietzel. But more to the point, from 1958, what had been conventional fan support took on slightly excessive overtones. Tiger Stadium turned into a loony bin and has been sold out ever since. The only way to really appreciate this is to go there on Saturday.
Here we go, Tigers, here we go. Come on, Bobo.
All right,
baby. Open up. We're ready for Freddy.
Hey, Bo.
Woo! Oh, yeah, look at this. Got everything. What the hell you got in there, Bo?
A football paraphernalia.
All right, Jalapeno, open the door, babe. Load her up.
We're going to give him a bobble.
On the left is restaurateur Axel Strombo. On the right, Jim Sullivan. Both are LSU fans in good standing and are embarking on a certified pilgrimage. It is a ritual that, with variations, is repeated numberless times across the state when the Tigers play at home.
Ready? Let's go look at that. Don't tell the truth. We're going to buy some when we get up there.
Ain't bad, Bo.
What do you mean, ain't bad, Bo? That's a damn good-looking hat, pal.
You're right.
Good enough? Look out, Joe. You're going with the snake bite kid, I see.
Got your little cup,
Peter? Let's take it nice and easy. It's gonna be so easy for us to fall in love.
My first experience when I walked through LSU Stadium was just unbelievable. And I've been a fan ever since. We've had a lot of hectic trips. It was really something to see. It gave me goosebumps, you know. It just moved me.
This is a place where Tigers put a lot of people to rest.
Right.
Let me give you a little list of the people they put to rest.
Give me a little list of the people they put to rest.
They put to rest Notre Dame here.
The man receiving the LSU histogram is Pete Rodriguez, a novice to fanhood. He is also about to discover that while true love for LSU football might take some time to develop, with the trip, at least half the fun is getting there.
Of course.
Georgia Tech, Mississippi State, Ole Miss, and them tramps.
From Chalmette.
No, those tramps from Auburn, Bo, not Chalmette. They don't play Chalmette. Chalmette ain't got a college yet.
Yeah, but Ole
Miss. We used to go up on a train, which was really kicks. We'd rent a bedroom on the train in later years. We'd go up there on the way up, we'd be playing cards, having a few drinks, and we'd go to the stadium, which was fantastic because you didn't have to worry about driving home if you had a few too many. And you'd get up in the stadium, and I've seen some of the best players at LSU, Stovall, Jimmy Taylor, Cannon, Tyler LaFosse. Their quarterback, Sweeney, Burt Jones, and it's just been a fantastic deal.
Here we go, Tigers, here we go. Here we go, Tigers, here we go. And there is the famous pillars are coming up.
Woo, I love it! da 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 da.
Welding shop, bouncer.
Anything,
whatever you want.
It's whatever you need. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You don't want to try to do it.
If you've seen one college game, you've seen them all. The colors and songs might vary, but there are a number of immutable quantities. One, of course, is the astonishing capacity of a youthful liver. At LSU, the results of this are exacerbated by the tradition of nighttime games. Booze is not allowed inside, but in spite of a cursory search at the gate, Tiger Stadium still qualifies as one of the world's largest open-air liquor warehouses on Saturday night. Another standard feature is the tailgate party. Hundreds of campers begin to fill into allotted and prepaid parking slots as early as 3 or 4 hours before kickoff. They comprise almost a small city and are even the subject of a TV show hosted, naturally, by a man called Superfan. But similarities aside, there is something special about a game in Tiger Stadium. Its size alone, over 76,000 seats, suggests that a newcomer is in for a noisy, if not unique, experience. The intensity of a capacity crowd is almost tactile.
Well, you had the Saturday night syndrome, really, and I think that built up as LSU got more successful nationally. 58, 59, 60, 61 era really turned the city on, and it just, you got a Saturday night syndrome. You had people there that the whole social calendar revolved around night football on Saturday nights. Your beauty shops, your department stores, your restaurants, and all that became just part of the fabric. And it still is to a great extent because LSU sells out, you know, game after game. Bobby Dodd, the old Georgia Tech coach, after coming in there in the 60s, compared it to the Roman Coliseum, you know, and he said he felt like a lion, you know, not like a lion, like a Christian going into Tiger Stadium. And I think the big thing, it's night football, it's you've got capacity crowds, and the way that Tiger Stadium is built is very steep. The noise level, it keeps the noise level in. And it's pretty tough on opposing teams. It's when you get 72,000 people in there, they'll go, 76,000. You know, the noise level is just, it's incredible. You just can't hear yourself.
It is called Death Valley. And an out-of-state sports writer describes the LSU crowd as the most hostile anywhere. One person who has experienced Death Valley as a recruit, a player, an assistant coach, and now as head coach is Jerry Stovall.
It's the thing to do. It's the social event of the day. I think we're about the sixth largest city in the state of Louisiana on Saturday night now with 80,000 in our stadium. Then to go back as an assistant coach a number of years later, after having played in most of the major arenas as a professional football player for 9 years, just had reconfirmed in my mind, this is still the greatest place in all the world to play college football.
The LSU band's pregame ceremony puts the finishing touches on what is already a fairly manic atmosphere. It is probably a throwback to Huey Long's penchant for hoopla, but no Tiger fan can resist the heady influence of Tiger Rag, the Louisiana equivalent to Deutschland über alles.
They'll send chills up your spine. I ain't shit. I mean, they will send chills up your spine when they do it. Because they real quiet. I mean, they quiet.
Damn it! Damn it!
Football dynasties are difficult to develop and even harder to sustain. Anyone who thinks that a national championship is a foregone conclusion will believe that a horsehair put in a bottle of water will turn into a snake. It is a mixed blessing, and unhappily for coaches, the fans never really recover. For example, after a championship year, an 8-3 season is catastrophe. Just ask Tom Osborne at Nebraska, or Jerry Faust at the all-time meat grinder, Notre Dame. Or for that matter, ask Jerry Stovall, who during his second losing season at LSU developed a duodenal ulcer, and his wife started getting obscene phone calls. It's an enchanting profession where longevity rests on the predictability of 19 and 20-year-olds, and weekly advice is offered from 100,000 laymen, give or take a few. Never mind, apparently Americans can't get enough football. Great news to Rune Arledge and orthopedic surgeons. And while there is mathematical certainty that at the end of a season more fans will suffer than will not, you know what springs eternal. Jack Andoni is receiving therapy while dispensing canapes and memorabilia.
Lack of confidence in Jerry Stovall.
Curly Brissett has reversed the color scheme on his house for luck. Harold Pelias still wears purple socks, but has new doors to be kicked in. And chef Axel Strombo, though not Pollyannic by nature, views the new season with what H.L. Mencken calls the confidence of a Christian holding five aces.
I love football and I love LSU, and I just think that the Tigers, with the recruiting they've had over the past 2 years, and I think Stovall ought to have his feet wet now. He ought to be ready to, you know, either get the job done or something's got to be done. The fans, number one, you know, I have people coming to place here. They're ready to go. They called up. He said, yeah, man, we counting them down. He's got his LSU fight song records out and everything, you know. He's counting the days down. He's marking them off on the calendar. So everybody's ready. They're ready for a big year. You know, it ought to be a real good year. They're strong offensively. I think they got a lot more depth now than they had before. And I just believe that they're going to have one hell of a football season. If they don't, I'm liable to jump off the bridge, you know? You know what I mean? Jesus, it sucks.